Allie, and speaking of friends, when I was in the seventh grade, I had a best friend, and her name was also Allie, and we did everything together, okay? We carpooled to school together, we sat next to each other in class, we ate lunch together, we carpooled home after school together, and we were best friends. And then, in the eighth grade, something tragic happened. Allie moved schools, and I did not know what to do with myself. The first day of eighth grade, I walked into school by myself because she wasn't there. I sat at lunch with other people. That was not very fun. I had to find new friends to sit in class with. And at the end of the day, I was so sad. I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know what I was going to do after school. And ultimately, I didn't even know who I was anymore. I found myself asking the question, who even am I? And maybe you're trying to figure out the answer to that question too. Believe it or not, that's a pretty big question, because you're not asking it to find out what your name is or what family you belong to or what city you're from. No, when you're asking this big question, what you're really asking is a question about your identity. Simply put, identity really just means who we are. It's what makes you, you. It's one simple word, but it carries a lot of meaning. When we think of who we are, chances are we think about it in a few different ways. Maybe for you, who you are is who you want to be. You like the things you like. You feel confident in the choices that you're making. You enjoy the friends you have. You feel like you've found the things you're good at. You like the sense of identity you have and the person that you're becoming. Or maybe for you, who you are is more about who others expect you to be. For as long as you can remember, people have told you who they want you to be. They might not actually say the words, but you know your parents wish you could be more like your older sibling. Or your teachers want you to be a better student. Or your friends need more time and attention from you. You constantly feel the pressure to live up to the expectations of the people in your life. Maybe you feel like you have to act or be a certain way because of your race or your family background. In a way, you feel like you're constantly working to make sure your identity makes them all happy at the end of the day. Maybe identity for you is about who you have to be. The circumstances in your life have put you in a position to play a certain role or be a certain person, whether you like it or not. Your mom left, so you have to step up and help take care of your younger siblings. Your coach made you the star player on your team, so you have to perform each and every week, even if you don't enjoy the sport anymore. You feel like you have to be tough in order to survive in your neighborhood you live in. No matter what your situation is, your identity isn't shaped so much by who you want to be, but instead, who you have to be. Or maybe your identity is more about who you're not. You think about who you are, and the first thing that comes to your head is, I'm not blank enough. Like, I'm not smart enough. I'm not athletic enough. I'm not outgoing enough. I'm not rich enough. I'm not popular enough. You could fill in the blank with just about anything there. This might be so real for you right now that you would answer the question, who am I, by saying, I'm not enough. Deep down, the real question you're asking is this: am I enough? This big question of identity is really complicated. And can I let you in on a little secret? It's one even adults find themselves asking sometimes. We're all looking to understand who we really are. And when we're not sure how to answer that big question, we start looking in all kinds of places to figure it out. Maybe the answer is in our performance. If we can just make good enough grades, or score enough points, or get the lead in the play, or be the nicest kid in our small group, that will be who we are. Or maybe the answer is an appearance. If we can wear the best clothes, or find the best way to style our hair, or get those braces off, then we'll find an identity we're happy with. Or maybe the answer is in relationships. If we find the right friends, or get enough likes and followers, or start dating the person we want, then we'll figure out who we are. Whatever it is you're looking to for help answering this big question about who you are, the problem is the answer never seems to stick. None of it seems quite right. And after all that, we're still left looking for an answer. We're still left wondering, who am I really? But our biggest questions like this one need better answers. Here's the good news. I've got an answer to this big question that I think is going to help all of us. And that answer comes from a real story that happened to a real kid a really long time ago. This kid's story was written down by a guy named John who followed Jesus during his life and ministry on earth. Of course, John saw a lot of really amazing things and he lived life alongside Jesus. And he wrote them all down so that we could know about them today. Now, I don't want to totally spoil the story, but before we get into it, I do want to give you a few important details. Besides Jesus, of course, the most important person in this story is a kid. We don't know for certain if this kid was a boy or a girl. We don't know where this kid came from or what their circumstances were. We don't know about their family or their hobbies or even if they believe and knew about Jesus before this moment. But what we do know is that the encounter this kid had with Jesus changed their life completely. So let's take a look at what happened. After this, Jesus went across the Galilee Sea, that is the Tiberias Sea. A large crowd followed him because they had seen the miraculous signs he had done among the sick. Jesus went up a mountain and sat there with his disciples. It was nearly time for Passover, the Jewish festival. Jesus looked up and saw the large crowd coming toward him. He asked Philip, "Where will we buy food to feed these people?" Jesus said this to test him, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "More than a half year's salary worth of food wouldn't be enough for each person to have even a little bit." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said, "A youth here has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what good is that for a crowd like this?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass there. They sat down, about 5,000 of them. Then Jesus took the bread. When he had given thanks, he distributed it to those who were sitting there. He did the same with the fish, each getting as much as they wanted. When they had plenty to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the leftover pieces so that nothing will be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of 5 barley loaves that had been left over by those who had eaten. When the people saw that he had done a miraculous sign, they said, "This is truly the prophet who is coming into the world." Jesus understood that they were about to come and force him to be their king, so he took refuge again alone on a mountain. So basically, there was Jesus standing in front of this crowd of people who all needed to eat. And who did he choose to help make that happen? This kid. It is important to know that back then, kids had very little value in society. They were treated more like property that belonged to their families rather than humans who had anything to offer. You can imagine how this kid must have felt because of that. On top of that, we know the kind of bread that this kid offered Jesus was a kind that mostly people who were poor had.
Bread?
And there were fish. This is certainly not enough food to feed a whole crowd. So you can imagine again, this kid probably thought very little about who they were in this bigger story. I mean, they were in a crowd of thousands. Nothing about this kid made it seem like they'd play an important part of the story here. But Jesus saw it differently. Of course Jesus could have provided enough to feed those people all on his own. He is God after all. He didn't need any help making miracles happen. But when Jesus looked at this kid, he saw more than what everyone else saw. He saw that this kid had more than enough. Why is this so important? Well, because what was true back then in this story is still true of us today. Jesus knows who we are, and more importantly, Jesus knows who he is. Our biggest questions deserve better answers, and just like this kid, we are made in the image of God. That's the most important answer to our biggest question about who we are. It's the most important thing about our identity. It's enough for us to know just how much Jesus knows and cares about us. And because Jesus is who he is, we can trust that he can do anything with anyone. Jesus wasn't limited by what this kid had or didn't have to offer, and the same is true for us. Jesus makes what we have and who we are enough. He turns our not enough into more than enough. Like we said, our biggest questions need better answers. So, the next time you have a big question about who you are, remember this. You don't have to prove you're enough. Are there areas of your life where you feel like you're not enough right now? Places where you're struggling to be confident and comfortable with who you are? Identify one area of your life where you feel like you're not enough. If you're not sure, think about these questions. What worries you? Where do you feel insecure? What questions make you nervous? When do you find yourself making excuses for not measuring up? The answers to these questions might help you realize where you're struggling with the big question of identity in your life right now. Then think about how you respond when you feel that way. Do you try to hide who you are or how you feel? Do you try to cover it up by pretending you're something that you're not? Do you change something about yourself to be who others want you to be? Instead of trying to prove we have what it takes or hide so nobody notices we're not who we want to be, or even pretend we're something we're not, we can remember this one thing, that the only answer that matters about who we are is the one that Jesus gives us. And he says who we are is enough. This week, I want you to simply commit to doing one thing to help you remember who you really are. Maybe it's writing down the truth that you don't have to prove you're enough. Maybe it's asking your group leader to remind you. Maybe it's memorizing a verse that helps you know this is true. In fact, let me give you one to start. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Whatever it is for you, I want you to look for answers to your big questions about identity in places that will remind you of what's true. You don't have to prove you're enough. One way you can start to believe this truth is by spending time with others who love Jesus and love you. That's where groups come in. The people in your group and your leader are there to help you process your biggest questions. The truth is, we were never meant to figure these questions out alone. And as we're all wrestling with the question of who am I, your group is a safe place to do that. They can help remind you that you're already enough. I'm gonna make my sandwich now. Fishy. Ew, that doesn't taste good, guys.